We are online. Okay, so hello everybody. My name is Emiliano Catonini. I'm an associate professor of microeconomics at the International College of Economics and Finance at Higher School of Economics, as you see here. So what we're going to talk about today is how decision making is troublesome sometimes when there is uncertainty about some relevant parameter of the problem. And this is a very relevant issue for economics and finance, so it's pervasive. So most economic and financial decisions are taken in conditions of uncertainty with respect to some relevant variable that we don't know about. And what we are going to see is like some prototypical problems of decision making and how game theory and decision theory tackle these problems in a way that it's applied in all fields of economics and finance. So basically everything that you learn at ICEF, okay, there is some elements of what we're going to talk about today. Okay, so I think we can start. I want this to be a bit interactive. Okay, at some point you will also be asked to actually cast some votes. Okay, and now start by considering the following game. So I'm going to toss a coin until the first head comes up, okay? And you're going to win n to the power of n euros, where n is the number of tosses that I do until the first head comes up. So for instance, if I toss the coin once and it's already head, you're going to win 2 euros. If I toss the coin 2 times, because the first is tail and the second is head, you're going to win 4 euros. If I need 3 tosses, you're going to win 8 euros, and so on and so forth, okay? So this is the game that I would like you to imagine, I would like you to participate to in an imaginary way because you're not in the room, but let's see what we can do. So now my question is, how much are you willing to pay to participate to this game, okay? So in the next iteration, I'm going to ask you to actually vote, okay? So to decide whether you're only willing to pay less than 10 euros, okay, to participate to this game, or if you're willing to pay between 10 euros and 1 million euros, or if you're even willing to pay more than 1 million euros to participate to this game, okay? So in this game, you never lose, but if it's head of the first time, you win only 2. If it's head of the second time for the first time, you win 4. If the first head comes up after 3 tosses, you win 8, and so on with the powers of 2, okay? So now if you understood the game and you're ready to vote, okay, we are going to vote on these 3 options, okay? So I'm going to start the voting now, and let's see how it works. If you have questions, you can always ask me a question in the chat, of course. I have the chat open here on my screen. So if you have questions about the game, about how to vote, you can ask me a question. I see that already 7 people have voted. If nobody else is going to vote, I'm going to stop the voting now. So I click finish voting. Okay, finally 10 people voted, and the final result of the voting is that 6 people are going to pay only less than 10 euros to participate to this game, 3 people are going to pay between 10 and 1 million euros, and 1 brave person is going to pay more than 1 million euros to participate to this game. Okay, what do we learn from this game? The expected value of this game is infinite, okay? Why? Because you're going to win 2 euros with probability 1/2, 4 euros with probability 1/4, 8 euros with probability 1 over 8, and so on and so forth. Now, if you compute the expected value, you have an infinite sum of 1s, okay? So an infinite sum of 1s is infinite. So when you are risk neutral, you look at the expected value of things. So the value you attach to an investment, to a prospect, to a game, is its expected value for you, OK? okay? It's monetary expected value. So if you are risk neutral, or even more if you are risk loving, you should be willing to enter this game at any cost. Okay, so you would definitely pay more than €1 million, okay, to enter this game. But also the person who voted to pay more than €1 million probably didn't have infinitely many euros in mind. Okay, but actually, many people consider themselves risk neutral or risk loving. What this game teaches to us is that we are all risk averse. Okay. So why we are all risk averse? Because even if this game has an expected value of infinite, we are not willing to pay infinite to participate to this game. The notion of risk aversion that we use in everyday life corresponds to some sort of pessimism. But in economics and in finance, risk aversion is not about pessimism. Okay, it's not about being pessimistic. It's just decreasing marginal utility of consumption. So it's just the fact that when you win €2 million, okay, this is going to give you a certain utility. And when you win €4 million, your utility is not twice as much as when you win €2 million. It's something less. So, and the reason is because our marginal utility from consumption is decreasing. So the first consumption we make makes us very happy. The second unit of consumption we have makes us happier, but not as much happier as the first unit, and so on and so forth. At some point, we are fed up, okay? So additional consumption doesn't bring us any additional benefit, okay? Now, then when we evaluate an investment or a prospect, we look at what is the utility for us of this investment or of this game in terms of utility, so in terms of consumption, not in terms of money. And indeed, if instead of evaluating the game with 2 for €2, 4 for €4, you use the utility that you get from €2, the utility that you get from €4, and so on and so forth, where the utility of €4 is less than twice the utility of €2, and so on and so forth, this sum, which was infinite, becomes finite, okay? Because U is a concave function. If U is sufficiently concave, then your utility function is concave, so your marginality of consumption decreases sufficiently fast. Then this game has no infinite value for you, as a finite value. Indeed, for a 6 person out of 10, this game even has a value which is less than €10. Okay, so a very small value for a game that has an infinite expected value. Okay, now this is actually was something that was created. So this game was created many centuries ago. Was created in Russia, in St. Petersburg, okay, by a mathematician called Bernoulli. It's called paradox, okay? Because, of course, it looks paradoxical that for a game that has an infinite expected value, nobody who is not crazy is going to pay infinite to participate to this game. So that's why it is a paradox, okay? But it's a paradox that has been solved in economics with risk aversion. So the reason why we don't pay infinite is because we are risk averse, and risk aversion means nothing else than decreasing marginal utility of consumption. It's not about being pessimistic. It's just about if I win additional amount of money at some point, I don't know what to do with it, okay? So I shouldn't count it like going to infinite. Let's move to a different problem now. Now, in this problem, you have to pick an activity for your next weekend, okay? So there are 4 activities you can do. You can go to sunbathe, you can go to ski, you can go for a run, or you can go to drive your car, okay? And if this activity makes you happy or not, 1 is like it makes you happy, 0 it doesn't make you happy, it depends on the weather conditions. So of course, if you go sunbathing, you get 1 util, okay, 1 unit of utility, only if it's sunny, otherwise you get 0. If you go to ski, it must snow. If it hasn't snowed, you don't get any utility from skiing, okay? But if it does not, you're happy and you ski. If you go for a run, you're fine when it's sunny, you're fine when it's cloudy, you're not fine when it's snowy, okay? You don't want to run under the snow. And if you go for a drive, now let's imagine that you only have fun driving your car when it's snowy or cloudy, because you like to drive the car on some slippery surface, okay, slippery road. So when it's sunny, you get zero utils, but when it's snowy or cloudy, you have fun driving your car. Okay, and so you get one util. So what is different in this problem from the coin game that we did before? What is different is that here you don't know the weather probabilities, okay? So the probability of tossing a coin, you know that it's going to be head with probability 1/2 and tail with probability 1/2. Everybody knows that. And so the probability of head at the first toss was 1/2. The probability of head at the second toss was the probability that you get first tail, 1/2, times the probability that you get head at the second toss, 1/2. So 1/2 times 1/2 was 1/4, and so on and so forth, okay? Here, weather is unpredictable. So nobody knows exactly what is the probability it's going to be sunny, or it is going to be snowy, or the probability it's going to be cloudy, okay? But what you know is that you will get one unit of utility if your activity fits well with the weather, and you get zero units of utility if the activity that you've chosen doesn't fit well with the weather, okay? Now, I'm going to ask you now the following problem. So suppose that you have decided that you'd rather plan to sunbathe than skiing, okay? So you consider sunbathing a better activity for the weekend than going to ski, okay? This probably means that, you know, you consider that sunny is more likely than snowy, right? Otherwise, you wouldn't go to sunbathe instead of ski, okay? But then I'm going to ask you the following question. Now, when you pick sunbathing over skiing, would you also pick running over driving, okay? So if your choice between sunbathing and skiing is sunbathing, okay, given these utilities, how they depend on the weather, are you going to choose to go for a run instead of driving your car, okay? Now, remember these utilities, okay? The sunbathing gives you 1 in case of sunny and 0 otherwise. Skiing gives you 1 in case of snowy and 0 otherwise. Running gives you 1 in case of sunny or cloudy and 0 for snowy. And driving gives you 0 under sunny and 1 under snowy or cloudy. Okay, now remember in this table, now I want you to answer the question that I just posed. So if it's true that when you choose sunbathing over skiing, it also looks reasonable to you to choose running over driving, okay? Now I started the voting. Is there a way to go back to the table, to show the table?
No, I'm not going to finish it.
Okay, 8 people have already voted. I'm going to stop it now. Okay, 9 people voted. 9 people voted for yes, and 4 people voted for no. Okay, let's see what these choices may depend on. So according to what is called the Schurfing principle, which is a principle in decision making that has been defined in the 50s by a decision theorist called Savage, the answer here for a person who is considered rational, according to this principle, is yes. Okay? And why is it yes? Because if you notice here in the table, okay, the difference between sunbathing and there is a difference between sunbathing and skiing under sunny and under snowy, but not under cloudy. So when you have to decide between sunbathing and skiing, you can actually ignore, okay, the possibility of cloudy, because in that case your choice doesn't make a difference. You can focus on what is better to do in case of sun or snow, okay? And then probably if you give higher priority to sun, then you say it's better to sunbathe. If you give higher priority to snow, it's better to go to ski. Now look at the choice between running and driving. Also running and driving give you exactly the same utility in case of cloudy, okay? So it seems that also in this case, also when you choose between running and driving, you can ignore the possibility that it's cloudy, because in case it's cloudy, that you go for a run or you go to drive, you're happy in the same way. So what makes a difference between running and driving is when it's sunny or snowy. But if you focus only on sunny and snowy, look at the fact that running and driving give you exactly the same utilities as sunbathing and skiing. So if you eliminate this column, the column cloudy, sunbathing and skiing under sunny and snowy look exactly like running and driving under sunny and snowy. So according to this principle, if you are what is called a subjective expectativity maximizer, subjective because there are no objective probabilities like for the coin, but you can have your subjective probabilistic assessment about whether it's going to be sunny, snowy, or cloudy. If you decide with these subjective probabilities in mind, when you compute the expected utility of sunbathing and you say this is higher than the expected utility of skiing, then also the expected utility of running will definitely be higher than the expected utility of driving, okay? Because you can, the two decision problems are identical under sunny and snowy, and under cloudy, your choice doesn't make a difference anyway, okay? So this is called the sure thing principle, okay? Where the sure thing is under cloudy, you get something for sure, independent of your choice. So when you get something for sure, this is irrelevant for your decision problem, okay? And if you only look at the column sunny and snowing, the decision problem between sunbathing and skiing is exactly the same decision problem that you have between running and driving, okay? So if you are a subjective expectativity maximizer, according to Savage, then you should answer yes to this question, okay? Now, let's go to the next slide. I'm going to propose you a different decision problem. There are 90 balls in an urn, okay? 30 balls are red. The other 60 are either yellow or blue, but you do not know which proportion. So you don't know how many are yellow, you don't know how many are blue, but you know that altogether there are 60 balls that are either yellow or blue. And the other 30 are red for sure. What I'm going to do is that I'm going to pick one ball from the urn at random, okay? And now I want you to bet on the color of the ball that I'm going to pick. First bet that I'm going to ask you is if you would bet on red or on yellow, okay? Again, I repeat, you know that there are 30 red balls in the urn, the other 60 are yellow or blue, but you don't know in what proportion, and I pick one ball at random. Okay, and given the same price for the bet, would you rather bet on red or yellow? And then I'm going to ask you a different bet. So I'm going to pick another ball, and I'm going to ask you, would you rather bet that this ball is red or blue, meaning that you win both if the ball is red and if the ball is blue? You're going to lose only if the ball is yellow. Or would you bet on yellow or blue, meaning that you win when the ball is yellow, you win when the ball is blue, but you lose when the ball is red, okay? So in both cases, you have to pick between two bets, okay? You can choose on what to bet, okay? So betting on red or betting on yellow, second decision problem, betting on red or blue, or betting on yellow or blue, okay? So if the problem is clear, and of course you can ask me a question in the chat if it's not clear, I'm going to start voting, so you have to tell me what you would bet in these two decision problems. What bet would you pick in this choice between bets? Seven people have already voted. Let's wait for someone else to vote. So I'm going to stop voting now. Very good. So nine people have voted, and the result is that like 8 people would bet on red instead of yellow. And then instead, between the choice of betting on red or blue or yellow or blue, people are more divided. So 4 people would bet on red or blue and 5 people on yellow or blue. Okay. Now, what do we observe here? That when the choice between red or yellow, the choice is between betting on a color of which you know there are 30 balls over 90. So there is probability 1/3 that the ball that I pick is red. So this is a known probability, like in the case of the coin. And the other bet has a probability of winning, which is not known. It's like the case of the weather, okay? Because you know that there are 60 balls that are either yellow or blue, but you don't know exactly how many are yellow, okay? So people go for the bet with known probability, okay? So which is the bet on red, which has probability of winning 1/3. The probability of winning with yellow is unknown, and people are more cautious towards it, and they say, I'm not going to bet on yellow. Then, when I ask to bet on red or blue or yellow or blue, here people are like almost half-half divided. So people who bet on red or blue don't know exactly the probability of winning. Because you know there are 30 red balls, but you don't know how many blue balls there are, okay? People who bet on yellow or blue instead this time know what is the probability of winning. Because the total number of balls that are yellow or blue is 60 over 90. So the bet on yellow or blue is probability of winning of 2/3, okay? Whereas the probability of red or blue is probability of winning, which is between 1/3 and 1, but you don't know exactly what is the probability of winning, okay? And notice that here most people voted for yellow or blue, okay? Which means they also here, although here is only a small majority, but here people voted for the bet with the sure probability of winning, where the probability of winning is exactly 2/3, okay? The other bet has not a clear probability of winning, so it's not like the case of the coin, it's more like the case of the weather, and therefore people tend to stay away from it, okay? Now, let's go back to our slides. I forgot how to go back to the slides, sorry. Thank you. Yes. So, as I said, most people choose red over yellow. And choosing red over yellow means that basically in your mind, the yellow balls are less than 30. But most people also choose yellow or blue over red or blue. And this makes sense if you think that the blue balls are less than 30, okay? And that's why this is also a paradox, okay? It's called Ellsberg paradox, because when you're facing the choice between betting on red and betting on yellow, you behave as if your assessment of how many yellow balls there are is less than 30, okay? But when I ask you, to choose a bet between yellow or blue or red or blue, most of you made a choice as if they had in mind that the blue balls are less than 30. So that the probability of red or blue of winning is less than 2/3. Okay, so less than the probability of winning with yellow or blue. And this is because we tend to make choices. So we tend to make choices for which we know the exact probabilities of success. Okay. When the probabilities of success are unknown, although maybe on average they are the same as other choices, we still tend to stay away from it, okay? But notice the following. This problem that I posed to you of choices between bets is exactly identical to the problem of the weather before, in the following sense, that the bet on red gives you one, so winning, okay, under one of the 3 possible states of the world, and 0 under the other 2. The bet on yellow makes you win also under one of the states of the world, and 0 under the 2 other states, okay? So this is exactly like sunbathing and skiing. Red, yellow, and blue are like sunny, snowy, cloudy, okay? Now, when you have to choose between red or blue and yellow or blue, okay, you win not under one state of the world, but under 2 states of the world. So with red or blue, you win under red, and you win under blue. And with yellow or blue, you win under yellow and you win under blue. Look, the table of utilities, depending on what is the true state of the world, so what you are uncertain about, is exactly the same like in the previous problem. But didn't we agree on the sure thing principle? Well, actually, we didn't agree on that, because many of you decided, despite of the decision of sunbathing over skiing, they still decided for driving over running. So, but still the majority agreed with the sure thing principle, okay? That if you choose the first over the second alternative, then you should choose the third alternative over the fourth alternative. Because under one state of the world, the choice is irrelevant, okay, 0, 0, 1, 1. And under the two other states of the world, the problem, the decision problem number one and the decision problem number two are identical, okay? Now, what happens here, let's stay a bit more in this slide, what happens here is that people are not expected utility maximizers, okay? This is what we call pessimism. It's called ambiguity aversion in economics and finance. So people tend to stay away from choices, investments, bets, okay, for which they don't know the exact probability of success. So there is ambiguity regarding what is the probability of winning, okay? This is called ambiguity aversion, and this is closer to what we would call in everyday life pessimism. Okay, because when you were choosing between betting on red or betting on yellow, you were pessimistic about the amount of yellow balls, okay? And so you decided to bet on red. But when you were deciding between betting on red or blue or yellow or blue, you became pessimistic about the amount of blue balls, at least most of you, okay? Most of you decided, well, what if blue balls are less than 30, okay? I'll be pessimistic about this. And so I'll bet on yellow or blue instead of red or blue, okay? So in this way, so by choosing people who chose red over yellow, but then chose yellow or blue over red or blue, violated the sure thing principle. And violating the sure thing principle means taking decisions that are not compatible with subjective expectativity maximization. So are not compatible with giving some probabilities to the states, computing expected values, and then choosing the alternative with the highest expected value, okay, expected utility, okay? So, and actually, so this notion of ambiguity aversion is very powerful in economics and finance. It's something actually that is starting to be quite recently applied. For instance, one of long-standing problems in finance is called the equity premium puzzle. Okay, in the equity premium puzzle, so the equity premium puzzle is the fact that stocks, okay, have an excess return with respect to bonds, okay, that cannot be explained just with risk aversion. So it's true that stocks are more risky than bonds, but they're not so much more risky to justify why returns on stocks are much higher than the returns on bonds, okay? And the explanation given by ambiguity aversion is that people tend not to buy stocks so that the return goes up for stocks. People tend not to buy stocks because they perceive the probability of success, so the probability that the investment in stocks goes well, they perceive it as ambiguous, okay? So they cannot really assess what is the probability that the stocks are going to go up in price, okay? Whereas with bonds, that seems to be easier, okay? Bonds have a return that it seems to be more predictable, okay, than stocks, and therefore investors know more or less what they can expect from bonds, okay? And this, and for this reason, since they're ambiguity averse, they tend to refrain from buying stocks that have a return of which they don't know exactly the probabilities, okay? Now we move to a different problem. So far, this was just decision theory, okay? Now we also are in decision theory, but I'm going to interact with you a bit more, okay? I'm not going to be like another player. I'm just going to be give you some information, okay, during the decision problem that may change your decisions. Okay. So now the problem is the following. It's actually a game with four cards. Okay, that I have here. So I have two aces. You have the ace of hearts and the ace of diamonds. And you have other two cards, which is two jacks. Okay, it's the jack of diamonds and the jack of hearts. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do, I shuffle these cards in the way that you don't see them, okay? And then you're not here with me in the room, so I cannot ask you to take two cards, but I'm going to do it for you, okay? So I'm going to take two cards from these four, okay? And the rule of the game is that if these two cards is the two jacks, then we redo it, okay? I'm going to pick two different cards. And I can already tell you that it's not the two jacks, okay? And if it's not the two jacks as it is, okay, I'm going to tell you a sentence, okay? I'm going to tell you the following sentence. You picked the ace of, and I'm going to say, hearts or diamonds, okay? And I'm not going to lie. So if I'm going to tell you you picked the ace of hearts, it's true. You, one of the two cards is the ace of hearts. If I say you picked the ace of diamonds, it's true. So one of the two cards is the ace of diamonds, okay? After that, I give you this additional information. Now you have to bet, okay? You can bet €1, so you can put €1 in the pot, and you're going to win something if the two cards is the two aces, okay? So the winning combination is the two aces, okay? Now, if the problem is clear, okay, so I'm going to tell you first a sentence. I'm going to tell you the sentence now. So you pick the ace of hearts, okay? It's true. So one of the two cards is the ace of hearts, okay? Now imagine that you have to bet €1, okay, on having picked the two aces. How much do you want to win, at least, okay, in case it's truly two aces, in order to be happy to participate to this bet? So in order to be happy to put this euro on the pot, okay? So I'm going to propose you three alternatives, okay? So do you want to win €3, okay, at least, to be happy to put €1 on this bet? Or you want to win at least €4 to be happy to participate to this bet? Or you require more, so you're going to put this euro in the pot only if, in case of two aces, I'm going to pay you more than €4. Okay. Now let's vote. So again, as usual, if you have questions, you can ask me in the chat. And I remind you that I told you the following. I gave you the following information on your two cards. You picked the ace of hearts. Okay. So one of the two cards is the ace of hearts. And now you must tell me how much you're willing to, how much you require as a price for the bet to be happy to bet €1 on having picked the two aces. Okay. Again, if you have questions, ask me in the chat. Otherwise, soon I'm going to stop the voting. Okay, now I stop it. So there are, again, 9 people who voted. Good that you're all still with me, these 9 people. So 2 are happy to get €3 in case it's the two aces. 3 people are happy with €4 to bet €1 to get 4 in case it's two aces. And 4 people are willing to bet €1 on the two aces only if they win more than €4 in case it's truly the two aces. Okay. Now, if you say 3 or 4, and we play this game many times, you're going to lose money, okay, after a while. Why is that the case? Well, first of all, three or four sounds like a reasonable answer in the following sense. Because once I told you that you picked the Ace of Hearts, and here is the Ace of Hearts, and by the way, you lost, because the other card is not an ace. So once you know that this card is the Ace of Hearts, how many combinations of cards are still possible? Well, you can have Ace of Hearts and Ace of and Jack of Hearts, as it was. You can have Ace of Hearts and Jack of Diamonds, or you can have Ace of Hearts and Ace of Diamonds. So there are three combinations left. So if you give the same weight to the three combinations, one combination is the winning combination, and the other two combinations are the losing combination. So it looks like you have probability 1/3 of winning. Okay. Therefore, if you have probability 1/3 of winning, it seems to make sense that to be indifferent, okay, between betting or not betting, you need to get in return €3. Or if you actually require to have some positive return from betting, you must be requiring at least €4. Okay, given that in this way of thinking, the probability of winning is 1/3. Okay. But the problem is that the three combinations are not equally likely, okay? Why they're not equally likely? So the winning combination, which is the two aces, okay? The combination two aces is less likely than the other two combinations. The reason is that if the two cards were the two aces, there were two sentences I could have told you. I could have told you you picked the Ace of Hearts, or I could have told you you picked the Ace of Diamonds, okay? Instead, when it's the Ace of Hearts and a Jack, I had no choice. The only sentence that I could tell you is the sentence that I actually told you, okay? Now, then, by Bayesian updating, okay, you should think that the combination with the two aces, the winning combination, is not as likely as the other combinations. Actually, the combination with the two aces has half probability with respect to each of the other two combinations, because the combination of with the two aces, only half of the times, okay, generates the sentence that I told you, okay? Whereas the losing combinations generate the sentence that I said every time. So the sentence that I gave, that I told you, the information that I gave you, is more likely to come from the losing combination than from the winning combination. So this signal that I gave you about your cards is more indicative of a losing combination than of a winning combination, okay? Another way to see the problem is the following. So there were six possible combinations. So when you have four cards and you take two cards out of four, there are six possible combinations that you can do, okay? And if it was the two jacks, I said we restart. Whenever it's not the two jacks, so with five combinations over six, I would have told you something, okay? It doesn't matter exactly what I would tell you. What matters is that, so for your decision problem, the only relevant information is that it's not the two jacks. Once it's not the two jacks, then this detail, what is the sign of one of the two of the ace that is in the combination, it's irrelevant for your decision problem, because I could have told you something in any case. So you should have thought there are five possible, well, there are not five possible combinations, but you should have like not listened to the sign, okay, of the ace, and you should have interpreted my sentence just as, well, there is one ace. Okay, if there is one ace, there are five combinations that are still possible. And at this point, if you reason in this way, they're all equally likely. Okay, so the probability of winning for you was 1/5. Okay, that's why you should require more than five, so five or more, so more than four, to be willing to participate to this game. Now, this game is called the Two Aces Paradox. And maybe some of you have already heard of the Monty Hall Paradox. Okay, this is very similar. Okay, it's very similar. I think it's framed in a slightly nicer way, but the concept behind it is analogous. Okay, is that when you are making a decision in conditions of uncertainty, and you get some information that reduces this uncertainty to you, okay, you should be very careful in interpreting this information. So something that you get is not really useful information for your decision. It could actually be deceiving, okay? And the right way to interpret what you're told is Bayesian updating, where you don't just listen to, you don't just incorporate the information that you got, but you also take into account, okay, what is the probability, okay, that this information comes from a certain state of the world or from another state of the world. And you have to give more probability to the state of the world that generates this information more often, okay? Now, after this, we are going to finally do some game theory. Okay, why some game theory? Because so far, all the decision problems that I gave you were one-person decision problems. So it was you against chance, okay? So if you would win or you would lose the bets would not depend on what the other people on the chat, the other people on this webinar would choose, okay? And now instead, from now on, you're going to interact, okay? How are you going to interact? This is the first game. So the game is called Guess Two-Thirds of the Average, okay? What I'm going to do is that, not now, okay, not yet, but I'm going to ask you to write in the chat a number between 1 and 100, okay? And I'm going then to do the sum of these numbers, okay? I'm going to do the average of these numbers, and I'm going to elect a winner. The winner is the person who submitted the number that is closest to two-thirds of the average of all the numbers you submitted. So be very careful that the winner is not the person who gets closest to the average of the numbers, but to two-thirds of the average of the numbers, okay? Now, you see that in this decision problem, if you're going to be the winner or not, it doesn't depend just on some random variable, okay, that is not under the control of anybody, like the weather or the coin, okay, or what they take from the book, from the urn. Here in this problem, if your choice is good or your choice is not good, so if you're going to be the closest to two-thirds of the average or not the closest to two-thirds of the average, depends on how the others behave. So now your uncertainty is the behavior of other players. And that is what game theory is about, okay? How game theory is different than decision theory, that there is an element of uncertainty which is not exogenous but is endogenous to the game. So it's the behavior of others like you who participate to the game, okay? So now I ask you please to write a number on the chat between 1 and 100, should be an integer number, please, and try to predict what the others do and be the closest to two-thirds of the average that the others will submit. Please start submitting your numbers in the chat. Take your time, think of what is your optimal choice. Okay, here, can the others see what other people see? Okay, actually, so in this game, actually, you should like write the number all at the same time, because if you see the numbers of others, then of course the last person is going to win. So please don't cheat, don't look at the numbers of others, just submit your number as if you haven't seen the numbers of the others yet, okay? Of course, this is a very experimental webinar, where it's the first time we try to involve you in games with voting, with chatting, and this is not the perfect technology for this game, but just imagine, okay, the situation that we want to represent. Okay, we have 8 numbers submitted. Usually we have 9 persons voting, maybe one left. Let me... Where is the 9th person? 9 persons not with us anymore, then I'm just going to do the average of these 8 numbers. No, I missed it. Have you done it? Mm-hmm. Have you done the average of the numbers? No? I'm going to redo it. Ah, okay. Okay, now we are 9. Okay, now I do it. I redo it. Okay, the average is 46. So 2/3 of the average is 31. So the winner is the person who said 33, so Stepan Labudin. Okay, congratulations, Stepan. Now, of course, this was not the ideal conditions for this game, okay, because Stepan actually saw the numbers. It's not by chance, I think, that the winner is one of the last submitters, because he could see the numbers of others. Now, when this game is played in the ideal conditions, okay, like I do it every year in class with my students, for instance, but this game has been played in many, many parts of the world, usually people submit a number at the same time, okay? And usually the winner is something around 20, okay? Here the winner is a bit of a higher number. Now, what does game theory say about this strategic situation? Actually, game theory would tell you that the optimal strategy is to submit one, exactly one. Why is that the case? Because you start the reasoning in this way. So the 2/3 of the average cannot be more than 67. Since everybody has to submit a number between 1 and 100, okay, the average cannot be higher than 100, therefore 2/3 of the average cannot be higher than 67. So if you want to be the closest to 2/3 of the average, you shouldn't submit more than 67, according to game theory, okay? But now game theory, as I said, is about also predicting what the others do, because what you're uncertain about is the behavior of others, okay? And so you try to put yourself in the shoes of others. So you say, well, if I concluded that I should not submit more than 67, maybe the others have come to this conclusion too. But then nobody is going to submit more than 67. If nobody submits more than 67, 2/3 of the average, so the average will not be higher than 67, so 2/3 of the average will not be higher than 44. So then I should not submit more than 44. But again, if the others, okay, reason in my same way, nobody is going to submit more than 44. And if nobody submits more than 44, the average is not going to be more than 44. 2/3 of the average is not going to be more than 30. Okay? If you go on in this way, you come to the conclusion that you should submit one. Okay? And this is what happens under something which is very famous in game theory, but say in economics and finance, which is the concept of common knowledge of rationality. Common knowledge of rationality means that everybody is rational, so everybody doesn't submit more than 67, because independently of what the others do, there is no way to win if you submit more than, there's no way that you are the closest to the average if you submit more than 67, okay? Then if you know that the others are rational, you know that nobody is going to submit more than 67, right? And in that case, you should not submit more than 44, and you go on in this way. So if you're rational, you believe that the others are rational, you believe the others believe that everybody is rational, okay? If you go on in this way, you come to the conclusion, well, we will all play one. But this is not what happens in reality. Because as soon as you introduce a little doubt, okay, a little doubt that there is common knowledge of rationality, so a little doubt in this reciprocal trust, that everybody doesn't play more than 67, everybody understands this, so everybody plays no more than 44. As soon as you introduce a little doubt that everybody is reasoning this way, well, then you should play differently. And indeed, the winner usually is something around 20. This game has been played many, many times in the world, and it never happens that the winner is a person who plays according to game theory, according to one, okay, that plays one. So because there is no common knowledge of rationality in reality, but still, common knowledge of rationality is an interesting theoretical benchmark, okay? How ideally people should reason, okay? And now, I will ask you the following. So please remember the number you submitted, okay, in the previous game. Now we're going to play a new game. This game is a very important game in economics, actually. It's an option, okay? Everything in almost like every kind of trading in economics that is not modeled like as a competitive market can be modeled as an option, okay? In this auction, there is an object on sale, okay? And you have your own valuation for the object, so how much you like the object. So now the number you previously submitted is how much you like the object. So if you submitted, I read here, 42, for instance, it means that you are happy to get the object for 42 or less. You are not happy to get the object for more than 42. But of course, you also like money, okay? So if your valuation for the object is 42, then if you pay not 42 for the object, but you pay 30, you're happier. If you pay 20, you're even happier. If you pay 1 for an object you evaluate 42, you're the happiest here, okay? Now, the rules now of the auction, so to win this object, which is just imaginary because you're not here in the room, the rules are the following. So you have to bid, okay? So you have to put like an amount of money, okay, in the chat, not now, when I will tell you to start. And again, you should do it all simultaneously, okay? So please don't look at each other's bids, okay, before putting yours. The rules of the auction may sound strange to you, but it's a very used format of auction in economics, and in the real economic world. So the winner is the person who bids the highest, and that's not surprising. But the payment for the object, so how much the winner pays, is not how much the winner has bid. It's the bid of the second bidder. So this is the second highest bid, okay? So if you win the object, you're not going to pay how much you bid, but you're going to pay how much the first loser, the loser with the highest bid, has bid. Okay, this is how much you're going to pay. Now, at this point, again, as usual, you can ask me questions in chat. If the rules of the auctions are clear, imagine that there is this object on sale. Exactly, so Stepan is asking me a question. Is my goal to buy this object? Your goal is to maximize your utility, okay? So, your utility is your value. If you don't win the object, your utility is zero. If you lose, your utility is zero. If you win the object, your utility is going to be how much you value the object. So in case of Stepan, it would be 33, because he wrote 33 in the previous game, minus how much you pay for the object. And if you win the object, how much you pay for the object is not your bid, but is the second highest bid, okay? So your goal is to maximize this expected utility. So probability of winning times the markup, so the margin you do from winning, which is your valuation of the object minus how much you pay for the object, okay? So if you, Stepan, win the object, you have a valuation of 33. If you end up paying 10 for the object, your utility is going to be 23. Okay? You maximize this utility, but considering that it's not sure that you're going to win. So your utility is the probability of winning times this number. Okay? But anyway, independently of this, just follow your instinct. Okay? There is an object on sale. You know how much you like the object, but of course you also like money. You want to spend as little as you can for the object, but you also want to win the object. You clearly have a trade-off here, because if you like bid 100, of course you win the object, okay? But then you're not happy because you pay 100 for something you value less. But you also don't want to bid zero, because if you bid zero, for sure you don't win the object, and you want at least to have a chance of winning the object at a price which is lower than your valuation, okay? We have this trade-off. You want to maximize your chances of winning, but you also want to win with the lowest possible payment, okay? If that is clear now, I ask you now, without looking at the bids of others, please, bid for the object, okay? Another question, the highest price is 100. Yes, you can bid up to 100, okay? Because your valuation is not higher than 100 anyway. Okay, we have already 1, 2, 3, 4, already 6 bids, 7 bids. Let's wait for the other two. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we have 7 bids. There is one person with a this exclamatory mark. Ah, okay, there is a person who lost the internet connection. Okay, we'll not wait for this person. So now let's see how your bids compare with your valuations. Okay, so we have Stepan, whose valuation of the object is 33 and the bid is 34. Okay, we have Karina, whose valuation of the object is 54 and the bid is 44. Cosmos has a valuation of 16, but bids 54. And Polina has a valuation of 90 and bids 67. Svetlana has a valuation of 45 and bids 50. Anastasia has a valuation of 26 and bids 62. Anshul has a valuation of 42 and bids 55. Juan Pablo bids 40, now he has a connection, and the valuation was 60, okay? Now, these results are surprising. Maybe I've not been clear enough about the rules, but I wouldn't expect anybody to bid higher than the valuation. It's like, you value the object, I don't know, 40, but you bid higher. You bid 60, okay? It means that you are running the risk of winning the object and paying more than how much you value the object. So it makes sense. So if you had a bid which was higher than your valuation, it would have been better for you to lower your bid, because if you lower your bid, you're still going to be the highest if the others bid lower than your valuation, but you're not going to win anymore if someone is bidding higher than your valuation. But if someone is bidding higher than your valuation, you're going to pay the object more than your valuation, so you're happy of losing, okay? Instead, some people had, as expected, a bid lower than the valuation. With a bid lower than the valuation, for sure, if you win the object, you're going to make a positive profit, okay? Because you win the object which is worth 50, and if you bid 40, at most you pay 40, not more than that, okay? So if you win, you make a positive margin, okay? And that's good. But are you playing well? So are you maximizing your chances of winning when you win with a positive margin. Well, actually, if your valuation is 50, instead of bidding 40, maybe it would be better to bid a bit higher. Because if this is what makes a difference for you between winning and losing, so bidding a bit higher than 40, suppose that with 40 you lose, but you bid 45 and with 45 you win, you're happy because your valuation is 50. If you're winning with 45, it means you're doing a positive profit because you're paying less than 45 for an object that you value 50. Okay? Now, in this particular case, the winner is Polina. Okay? Polina with 67 because she has the highest bid. Okay? Her valuation was 90. Okay? So how much does she pay for the object which she values 90? The second bid. The second bid is the bid of Anshul. Anshul has bid 55. So Polina in this auction is winning the object and is paying 55 for the object. The object has a valuation of 90, so 90 minus 55. She's making a positive profit of 35. Okay? So now Anshul had a bid of 55 and a valuation of 42. So he's happy he hasn't won, okay? Because if he had won with 55, then he could have paid more than he values the object. Now, there is Juan Pablo, okay? Juan Pablo has a valuation of 60, okay? And the object was won by Polina for a price of 55. Now, Juan Pablo would have been happy to win the object at the price that Polina paid for the object. Now, there was no chance for Juan Pablo to do better because Polina has a bid of 67. So if he was bidding more than 67, he would pay 67 for the object, which is higher than the valuation. But suppose that Polina won the object for price 55, but with a bid which was just 57, okay? Then Juan Pablo would regret not bidding more than 57, because he would have paid 57 for an object that he values 60. Okay? Now, what is this bringing us? This is bringing us to the conclusion that what seems to be optimal in this kind of auction is to bid exactly your valuation, as some people of you actually did. Okay? Actually, bidding your valuation in this auction is a weakly dominant strategy. In game theory, we say something is weakly dominant, an action is weakly dominant, when it is better than any other action, better or not worse than any other action, no matter what the others do. Now, in a second price auction, so in an auction where you don't pay what you bid, but you pay the second highest bid, it is weakly dominant for you to bid exactly your valuation. Because if you bid more than your valuation, you are increasing your chances of winning only in situations where you're going to end up to pay more than your valuation for the object. So you're increasing your chances of winning a situation where you are not happy to win. If you reduce your bid with respect to your valuation, okay, then what happens is that you're losing chances of winning in situations where you would have been happy to win, because the second price was lower than your valuation, and so you would have been happy to win the object and pay less than your valuation for the object. Now, there is a part of a branch of game theory which is called mechanism design. Mechanism design is the science of not solving games like we did with 2/3 of the average, but it's the science of creating games, designing games, designing markets, for instance, okay, designing auctions, okay? You design auctions with two goals in mind, usually. Well, there is a goal, which is like the interest of the designer. For instance, if I want to put an auction on sale, an object on sale, and I choose an auction format, I want to maximize my revenues, okay? So I'm going to choose the game, I'm going to choose the rules of the auction in such a way that I think people will bid higher and will pay higher, okay? But there is also another goal when you design a game, which is to make it simple to play, okay? Because as we saw in Guess 2/3 of the Average, you cannot really rely on common knowledge of rationality, reality. Okay, you can, the prediction of game theory sometimes are not what you observe in reality. Okay, because common knowledge of rationality requires a lot of thinking and a lot of trust in the other thinking in the same way. So you try to create a game, you try to create an auction that doesn't require so much thinking. And this is the auction that we just did. So the second price auction is the simplest possible action format to play, because you have a weakly dominant strategy, which means something which is optimal regardless of what the others do. So you kill the difficulty of game theory, which is the uncertainty about the others. You don't have to reason about what the others do to decide that your optimal action is to beat exactly your valuation. So all the problems we saw before, all these problems you have in decision under uncertainty, disappear if you design the game in this way. So if you design a second price auction, because it's enough that you realize that no matter what the others do, you will never regret having put as a bid exactly your valuation. You shouldn't think about what the others do. Just bid your valuation and you'll never regret it, okay? Independently of what the others do. Now, this was the last thing I had to say. It was 1 hour and 6 minutes, okay? 6 minutes more than I thought. But it's not over yet, the presentation, because now I'm going to talk about what we do here at ICEF and what is more interesting for you, actually. So what we do for students here at ICEF. So first of all, ICEF is a large program, okay? So we have more than 1,000 full-time students, of which 5 to 10% are international students. Sorry, this is not just ICEF, when we read 150 professors, okay? At ICEF, we are like around 30, okay, full-time professors. 150 is also including the Department of Economics at Higher School of Economics. Anyway, what is important is that almost everybody that is going to teach you at ICEF is hired on the global job market according to international procedures. So it is a person with a PhD, usually from a world-renowned institution. For instance, my PhD is from Bocconi University in Milan. And what we are going to offer to you is two programs, a bachelor program and a master program. So the bachelor program is a double degree program, okay? It's between Higher School of Economics and University of London. So you actually get 2 degrees, okay? One from HSE and one from London University of London, okay? And then we have the master program in financial economics, okay? Which is among the top 100 programs in the world for financial economics, master programs. And this is also in cooperation with London, with London School of Economics, which is the graduate school of University of London for economics and finance. And in this case, it's not exactly a double degree program, but you have the certification of London School of Economics. And indeed, with this certification, our students can go to work. Very often they go to work to the City of London, for instance, and to other parts of Europe. In terms of research, what we do at ICEF, we have, of course, a strong group of researchers in financial economics, which is the topic, that's why it's the topic of the main topic of the master program. Our researcher, so our professor, publish in top international journals, top 5 journals in economics, the top 3 journals in finance, top field journals in many fields of economics, and so on and so forth. We organize a conference every year in financial economics, which is an important conference on this topic. A conference in applied economics instead, so for people who are more interested in economics than in finance. And now I want to focus a bit, given your interest for being here, on what is the master program in financial economics about, okay? So the master program has some core courses, which is microeconomics, macroeconomics, econometrics, asset pricing, corporate finance. Some of these courses are, as you see, rather theoretical. But that's actually the strength of the program. It's not a program that only teaches you some practical skills that you can immediately apply on the job, but it's a program that teaches you some very general, okay, skills from economics and finance that are going to be very useful for you in the long run, okay, in your career, and are also very appreciated from your employer. And also give you actually the chance to go to for a PhD, so to continue your studies after the master program, because it's not a master program, it's only targeting some professional skills, okay? Besides these like core courses, there are elective and optional courses. There are more than 12 applied courses. So in this pool of courses, you will actually see topics that are very connected to what you would do in your future work, your future job. Some are taught by the PhD faculty, so by the full-time professors at ICEF. Some are taught by people with an MBA, so people who actually work in finance and economics in Moscow. And some people, as I said, are actually people in the business, okay, who come to ICEF to teach and bring to you their experience from the field, okay? The duration of the program is 2 years. The language of instruction is English. And during these 2 years, you will have opportunities to get a double degree and to go for an exchange, okay? These are really nice opportunities you have in this program because they allow you to spend a period abroad. The double degree programs are with LUIS in Rome. There is exchange program with Tilburg University in the Netherlands, University of Essex in Britain, and much more, okay? And as I said, what you obtain is the MSc diploma from HSC, so the master degree from HSC, plus on top of that, you obtain the letter of validation from London School of Economics, okay? And if you do, of course, a double degree, you obtain a master degree, from the institution where you go for the double program, okay, for the double diploma. In terms of career paths, okay, many of our students go to work as economists or analysts in investment banking and in strategic consulting and also in other areas of the economy. And many of our students, of course, it's compared to the people who go in investment banking and consulting, it's a small majority, but it's a significant number of students who, after our master program, decide to continue studying in a PhD. And they will do their PhD in top-ranked world universities, okay, in the US, in the UK, in other parts of Europe, okay. The tuition fee is 430,000 rubles, which corresponds to $6,500 US dollars, but there is financial support. Okay, so there are scholarships you can apply for from ICEF, from Viterbo. So consult our website, and if you have any question, you see here on the slide the email address where you should address your questions. Whenever you apply for our program, you can also apply for scholarships. And many of our students actually get a scholarship. And finally, I want to point you to this opportunity, which is very, very nice. It's a summer course that we're going to hold here in Moscow. It's a summer school in financial economics. It's going to take place at our institution between August 3 and August 8 this year. It's a very nice time of the year to be in Moscow. So it's an intensive course where you're going to meet other people like you, international people. You're going to meet our faculty, so it's going to be taught by our faculty. So the same professors you will meet in the master program if you decide to apply and to come here. The applications are open until April the 20th, okay? Of course, the earlier you apply, the better it is, but applications are open until the 20th of April, and it's really a great opportunity to get acquainted for our program. So it's particularly indicated for those who are about to start their last year of undergraduate studies. So they can come here in summer, get to know us, get to know our program, and maybe decide to apply for the master program for the next year. But it's also targeting master students because the level of the program is high. So even if you're already doing another master program, so you're not interested in coming to our master in financial economics, you should really consider coming for the summer school because it's great for your CV. It's a great experience for your summer. It's great to meet other students. And it's great to meet us, our faculty, okay? And you for sure you will learn something important for your future life. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say. So thank you so much for participating to the webinar, for staying until the end, despite of the, it was a very experimental webinar with voting and with, yeah, submitting your, oh, thank you to, so Cosmos is thanking me. No, my thanks are really to you because I really hope that you got at least a bit curious today about my disciplines, which is decision theory and game theory, and you got just a glimpse of how these things that appear to be very theoretical and very abstract, but how they appear everywhere in every decision you can take in an economic or financial environment. Okay, so thank you all for the attention and hope to see you here in summer or even in our master program. Okay, bye-bye.